clear of Seaford. Councillor Rodney Reid welcomes you to Seaford Town Council's annual civic service, held here at Seaford Baptist Church. God save the Queen!
Welcome to our virtual civic service here in Seaford. It's my privilege to serve as the Mayor's Chaplain this year. So a warm welcome to all those watching this service, and we hope that many more of you are able to watch today than would normally have come to an actual service. There are contributions from different groups in the town, including a children's choir from Seaford Primary School and the Seaford Silver Band. As all churches in the UK have been closed for the last 4 months, we have adapted to new ways of worshipping together. As we gather virtually today, it's right that we begin in prayer. Our world has been rocked by the coronavirus pandemic, but what I believe as a Christian minister is that we have a God who is faithful and who we can trust, who will never leave us or forsake us. Let us pray together. Lord, you are our light and our salvation. You protect us from danger. You remove our fears from us. You invite us to worship you. We trust you and do not despair. We know that we will live to see your goodness in this life, and we are confident that if we put our trust in you, that you will offer us everlasting life. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Saviour. Amen.
In the darkness, we were made without hope, without light. Praise the Father.
came to Seaford for a quiet retirement. In 2019, however, I was elected Martello Rotary President, and now, just as I'm ending my time as club president, I'm appointed mayor. It's a strange way to have a quiet retirement, but I do really like living in Seaford, the lovely natural environment, and the friendly, community-minded people. It's also a strange time to be mayor. I suppose I'm Seaford's first virtual mayor, chairing council meetings by Zoom, holding discussions with colleagues by telephone rather than face-to-face, interviews for BBC local radio and Seahaven FM by telephone. The mayor's Facebook is, for the time being, one of my main ways to communicate with the town. Several councillors approached me several times before I agreed for my name to be put forward to stand for mayor. Then came the unanimous support of the council in the chamber at the vote, and here I am today. I was particularly pleased that Councillor Jean Cash was appointed deputy mayor. My appointment as mayor was announced by the town crier of Seaford, socially distanced, in front of the St Leonard's Church lychgate. I was delighted that my wife Anne could make time amongst her rotary and inner wheel duties to be there with me as mayor's consort. That announcement followed the chain of office being passed over to me, socially distanced and in the open air. My wife and I are members of Seaford Baptist Church, so I was pleased when Andy Machin, minister here, agreed to be mayor's chaplain. This is a civic service, whereas the mayor's carol service is what it says it is. The civic service is for the town, councillors, officers, businesses, and community. This is a civic service, not a mayor's service, and of course, civic includes charity and voluntary groups, education, healthcare, police, fire, ambulance, lifeboat, lifeguards, and a lot else that makes Seaford, Seaford. What I'm hoping to do in my year as mayor is to encourage a spirit of cooperation between councillors and between councillors and our excellent team of officers. I look forward to playing a part in Seaford as a community coming out of lockdown and to Seaford returning to business as usual. I intend to encourage the Shop Local initiative. I'm happy to be invited to events and openings when that's permitted, and the Mayor's Secretary stands ready to take bookings. I found my first weeks of being a virtual mayor isolating. I realise, however, that others have had more difficulties to endure in being quarantined and in self-isolation. I've seen some of these difficulties in my doorstep contacts with residents through the Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team and the Seahaven Storehouse Food Bank. I've been impressed by the way that many local charities and voluntary groups have persevered and have found new ways to continue serving the town. The Youth Counselling Project is an example of a local charity continuing to provide support during social isolation by using innovative approaches. I've announced a multi-charity support initiative because together we are stronger. The community of the town is our strength. Our strength isn't just from the wind, though we do have a lot of that as well. I would like to thank everyone who has contributed to this virtual civic service. Particular thanks to Andy Machin, the Mayor's chaplain and minister here, and thanks also to the members for agreeing for this to be the venue for the 2020 civic service. Thanks also to Peter White, our town crier, and Sergeant at Mace, to Sue Treadwell, the Mayor's secretary, and particular thanks to the groups and individuals who have contributed video to this virtual civic service. The Seaford Town Council and the Seaford Baptist Church technical teams have cooperated and so been able to bring this together into a coherent whole. Another example of how we are stronger when we work together. The community spirit in our town during the COVID-19 pandemic has been admirable. I do hope that we can harness all that energy in our community, sustaining it and going forward together. And now back to Andy Machin as the Mayor's Chaplain.
Merciful God, we pray for our Mayor and all the elected councillors of our town, that in council or debate, their thoughts and words may be consistent always with truth, integrity, and justice, that they may never be blind to the needs and aspirations of those they serve, May all their deliberations and decisions be for the good of the people of this town and be in harmony with your will. Amen. We're going to hear now a couple of interviews. The first one with Sarah McStravick, part of the organising group for the Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team, who have done such an amazing job over the last few months in recruiting volunteers to help those who've had to isolate themselves because of coronavirus. The second is with Dawn Woodgate from Sea Haven Storehouse, our local food bank, who've seen a big increase in the numbers of people coming to them for help. Well, delighted to welcome Sarah McStravick here today. Sarah's from the Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team. And Sarah, could you just give us an idea about how the team started up in the last 3 months ago?
Thank you, Andy. It's great to be here. Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team actually started in 2015. We were started as a group that wanted to respond to local community issues. The main one being at that time was flooding in the town. We would go and support particular groups in the town who'd been flooded out, and people with 4x4s would come to the downs and pick up some sandbags and then take them to wherever in the town was needed and support those people within the community. At about middle of March, I would imagine the beginning of March, I was living and working in London and was recognising that the pandemic, the virus, was going to have a big implication for the population of Seaford. And I thought one of the things that we could do was to use the Facebook group Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team to ensure that we could coordinate a response for Seaford and make sure that those who were the most vulnerable could be as safeguarded as possible, working with the whole community. And I've got to admit, Seaford, as they always do, really do come up trumps. Mm. Thank you.
Brilliant. And I mean, how which organisations have been involved in SVET?
First of all, I reached out to just some friends. I spoke to Seaford Town Councillors. I spoke to some Lewes District Councillors. I was then approached by Churches Together, particularly the Reverend Arwen Fuchs, who's been really, really helpful. But I know that we've had some great help from St Leonard's Church as well, managing our finances and helping us with our safeguarding. I know here at the Baptist Church, you've been also very helpful with us with that. We've worked very closely throughout this project with the food bank and also support from Rotary, that's Seaford Rotary and the Martello Rotary. And we wouldn't have been able to do that without the support of all those organisations. Sure. And I must also include 3VA, which is the umbrella organisation for voluntary organisations across East Sussex, who have provided us with a great deal of support and knowledge along the way. There probably are some others out there that I can't actually remember at the moment, but many individuals in the town who've stepped up really have. One of the things we wanted to do was not only support the most vulnerable, but make sure our local businesses were as supported as possible. We're great in Seaford. We've got a butcher, a baker, a candlestick maker, and we really wanted to make sure that they were going to survive as well.
Yes.
And we were lucky in Seaford as well that we were given the opportunity that people with skills came forward for us. And one of our team is a web designer team from Hot Horse who have provided us with the most fantastic database. Brilliant. And that has enabled us to do that. Yeah. And as I say, the church has provided us with a helpline and the churches have also helped us with safeguarding issues.
Yeah. That's great. And how many volunteers have been helping with the deliveries of food and prescriptions and so on?
I'd say about 270 are on our... Yes,
yeah,
we've got about
270. People,
it is indeed,
yeah,
yes.
That's brilliant.
Yeah. And they, it's not just once, they've been out time and time and time again. So
yeah,
thank you
yeah.
to each and every one of you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's great news. And what do you think the sort of legacy is going to be of this, Sarah? Ongoing, is there going to be an ongoing sort of legacy that you can build on from what's happened?
Seaford's one of those great communities, isn't it, where I think the legacy is that we've become a stronger community together throughout this, and I hope that's one of the legacies that we take with us. Yeah. We are going to have to, we always fight the sea. We know that there's going to be another crisis coming down the line, even if it does go back to just be flooding in the town. Although we've been very lucky to also have on board with us a group that came together looking at the emotional well-being for people in the town, particularly for those who have been locked down for such a long time, and that's been a particular concern of ours. Mm. And Sea Friends will be continuing in the town going forward, and we very much welcome that, and that's a great success from Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team.
That's brilliant, isn't it?
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed, Sarah. That's great. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Today we have Christina with us. My name is Alex. I'm a youth worker in Seaford. And today we're going to find out a little bit about the Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team. And Christina is someone who has used this service. So we're going to find out how useful it was. So Christina, if you could maybe say first how you found out about the Seaford Volunteer Emergency Team.
Yeah, I found out in a couple of ways, actually. One was through Facebook and online. And then a couple of weeks after that, we all got information cards put through the letterbox, which was also really useful.
Oh, brilliant. Okay. So it's good. I mean, I guess, yeah, online and through doors is going to cover most bases, isn't it? So how did they help you? What difference did they make for you at this time, which is, you know, obviously something that none of us have really experienced before?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm still using their service now. I'm actually 101 days into my lockdown. And as a disabled person who had up until about 2 or 3 weeks before lockdown actually been completely housebound for 5 months, I was reliant on getting my shopping delivered. And then with the rise of lockdown and everybody needing to shop online, it became impossible to get delivery slots. We actually had food from supermarkets that was due to come to us that then at the last minute was cancelled, and we were already getting towards empty cupboard stage. So things were getting a little bit desperate, and we were reliant on other people to go to the shops for us during that time. And the difference it's made is obviously enormous, because it takes weight off your mind. You know there's a service there, so no longer spending hours and hours every day searching the internet for items of food that I can't get. And particularly at that time, there were a lot of empty shelves, so even if you managed to get some shopping, maybe the items you needed weren't there. And I've also used them for collecting prescriptions, which in our house is a regular occurrence. And so that's been really useful. And yeah, I've been continuing to use that service, even though we can get supermarket deliveries, because sometimes there's things that supermarkets don't sell that you need. And it's also been quite good, because it means we can use local shops as well, and still give them our custom or buy it via a volunteer route.
Oh, brilliant. No, that sounds really good. I mean, they sound like they've made a massive difference for you. So I wonder, just you might not be too sure, but what would you have done if the Seaford Emergency Volunteer Team weren't there?
Yeah, we'd have been really stuck. I mean, I had asked a couple of friends if they could add things to their shopping list. So we'd been doing a little bit of that. But it was desperate. I'm actually now part of a court case taking supermarkets to court for discrimination, because so many disabled people have just been unable to access online shopping. So yeah, it's a desperate situation for many people, and a lot of people are far worse off than us. And yeah, it's not just me that it's affected. So I mean, it's been an absolutely vital service, and I can see that from the responses on the comments page on Facebook, on their page. You can see that people are still needing that service even as lockdown is starting to ease. It remains a very scary time for any of us with existing health conditions, because as other people's social distancing relaxes, it makes it more precarious for us if we step outside the house. And it's easy to think that you might get forgotten along the way because other venues are opening and we're still stuck at home. And it, although I'm actually lucky enough to be able to go outside of the house, I don't want to come into contact with anybody. Some people aren't able to leave the house at all. But it still means that I can't go into shops and I can't come into close proximity with people. So it's still very isolating, even in my situation. So this service is an absolute lifesaver, really.
Sure. Oh, it sounds like, even though, like you said, things are being eased and lots of people are going out a bit more, but actually it's still going to be a vital service right now, probably for a good little while longer as well.
Yeah, and I think beyond lockdown as well, I mean, as a disabled person, I know what it's like to be stuck at home. I know what it's like to become isolated. And there's many, many people living in Seaford who are in that situation, maybe not through disability, maybe through old age or infirmity or reduced mobility. But that sort of service can continue beyond lockdown and still be really vital to people locally. I mean, that would be an amazing thing to happen. Something really positive to come out of the whole pandemic crisis.
Yeah, no, definitely. I think that that's what this has been, you know, although, you know, there's lots of people have found things very hard, there have been some good things to come out of it, and actually people have really pulled together and been a really kind of community spirit along with some of, you know, this time.
Yes, there's some negative bits where it's shown sort of the worst of humanity, but there's also a hell of a lot of positive bits where it's shown the best of humanity, and that's really uplifting. And I think it's especially at a time of isolation where people are finding it harder to be connected with people, it's stories like that where something's come just from local people coming together and creating something, you know, really needed but also really positive. That's fabulous.
No, definitely. Oh, that's great. Oh, well, thank you for giving up your time today. That's pleasure. Brilliant, and thank you for your input.
Yeah, fine. Thanks.
I'm here with Dawn Woodgate at Seahaven Storehouse, who is being a massive blessing to people in Seaford and New Haven at this time. Dawn, why don't you tell us a bit about how much food we've got, Fox here, how much food you're able to, you've been giving away week by week using the storehouse at this time.
So we're giving away at least 97 to 100 food parcels each week.
And this is a food parcel?
Yeah, and each food parcel weighs between 17 and 35 kilograms.
It's 2.5 tons of food each week going to local families.
Certainly, yeah.
That's amazing. Where's the food come from?
I don't know. to be honest, people are giving us money, but God's blessing it. That's the only way I can say God's blessing it. And it's almost like we're riding a tidal wave of love, where he's just showering love on people and sharing his love on us, and he's just blessing us. And I think, like I've said before, all I need to do is listen to Holy Spirit and be obedient. Yeah. And that's all I do, and just his little kid.
Wow.
Doing what he's asked me to do.
Have you noticed the demand or the need for it gone up over the last few weeks?
Yeah. Oh yeah, because we were doing 35 and it's now 100. Oh, which wow. 36 of those are the Waves families. So, but I really wanted to bless them. Yeah. I wanted the families that Jane's looking after to be well looked after.
So it's about an increase of 3 times as much as normal.
It
as
is,
a result
yeah.
of the pandemic.
Yeah, it certainly is, yeah.
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 Wow, you guys and are doing an amazing job organising it. I've seen the army of volunteers and people sorting out all the food each week. It must take such a long time.
Interestingly enough, all my volunteers aren't Christians. It's amazing because every week we stand up and we pray, and God's really blessing them. And then we pray for the folk we're delivering to, but they are parcel bombs of love. And
wow.
I just know God's doing stuff in people's hearts, and at some point we'll see what he's doing.
Wow, great. Thank you so much, Dawn, for sharing your heart, and it is amazing to be able to just be involved in a small way in all that you're doing. So
are you
thank
enjoying
you.
It?
Yeah, we are, really.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Isn't it amazing being involved with what God's doing?
It
Do you
is.
Not find that great?
Yeah, yeah. Very exciting.
And now I'm going to lead us in a time of prayer. Loving God, strengthen our innermost being with your love that bears all things, even the weight of this global pandemic, even the long haul of watching for symptoms, of patiently waiting for this to pass, watching and waiting, keeping our gaze fixed on you and looking out for our neighbours near and far. Instill in our shaken souls the belief and hope that all things are possible with your creative love. For strangers to become friends, for science to source solutions, for resources to be generously shared so everyone, everywhere, may have what they need. For your perfect love that knows no borders may cast out any fear and selfishness that divides. May your love that never ends be our comfort, our strength, and our guide for the well-being of all and the glory of God. Amen. We pray for our own town of Seaford. We give thanks for those who have volunteered to help others during this time. We remember with gratitude our health service workers, care workers, those who work in shops and collect our rubbish, the school teachers who have continued to teach vulnerable children and children of key workers. We thank you for ways in which organisations have worked together for the common good. And we pray that these positive and community building activities will not be lost when the restrictions ease, and that we will continue to see cooperation flourish so that the kingdom values of love and justice and mercy are evident in all that happens in Seaford. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Loving God, we pray that we and all people may increasingly work together to establish on earth the rule of the kingdom of heaven, that the resources of the world may be gathered, distributed, and used with unselfish motives and scientific skill for the greatest benefit of all, that beauty may be given to our towns and cities, that our countryside may be left untarnished, that there may be open ways of peace and freedom across our world, that there will be justice and righteousness for people of all races, colours and backgrounds. May you guide us and empower us, Holy Spirit, to each seek the good of others and our community. Amen.
Thank you. Our reading today is from Luke 10, verses 1 to 6. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If a man of peace is there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you." That is the end of the reading. Praise be to God.
Stay there, eating and drinking, whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around town from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, "The kingdom of God has come near to you." But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, "Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town." Here ends the lesson.
The first time I met Rodney, our new mayor, was around 20 years ago. I was training to be a Baptist minister, and a group of us visited inner city Birmingham, looking at how Christian churches interacted with other faith groups. We went to Rodney's church, and he explained to us how the church he and Anne belonged to carried out the mission of God in a multi-faith setting. The key element was about building trust between different groups and working in partnership with the local authorities in the area. Rather than each working in separate ways, they were stronger working together. It was clear that their church had an outward focus, looking at how they could meet the needs of their local community. And our passage today reminds us it's important for us to remember that Jesus sends us out to be witnesses, truth bearers, and his ambassadors to the places where we are called. That's why I chose this passage today, because here we see Jesus having equipped and trained the 72 disciples, sending them out to put into practice what they had learnt from him. Jesus had shown them how to heal people physically and spiritually. So now they are to put that into practice, going out in twos so they could support each other as they go to places they would not normally have expected to be in. Some of you listening to this will know that after I met Rodney for the first time, he and Anne were called overseas to serve God in Bangladesh. I don't think they would have expected to have gone to Bangladesh, but they were able to use the experience they'd gained in Birmingham in working in a majority Muslim country, seeking to bring change to benefit those working in the clothing industry there. There they sought out people of peace who also wanted to implement changes to working conditions, and gradually change happened. You'll see from the Bible passage that Jesus instructs his disciples to seek out people of peace in the towns that they go to. These are people who the grace of God rests upon. They're not necessarily fellow believers, but they are people who have the good of the community at the forefront of their thinking. The welfare of the people is what is uppermost in their minds. I believe we have many people of peace here in Seaford, where there's a strong community ethos. I've met many of those folk already, from different churches and from the community as a whole. It's been amazing to see how 200 people have volunteered to help the Svetti during the recent lockdown, delivering food and picking up prescriptions for those who are isolated. The challenge will be going forward that many of our organisations in the town, including the churches, rely on volunteers who may be more mature in years. Suddenly, if you're over 70, you're classed as vulnerable. Now, I know that many of you have said, I don't see myself as vulnerable just because of my age. And yet that may preclude them from volunteering in the future. So how do we address this problem? Well, I think our Bible passage gives us some guidance here. Firstly, as we see two people working together and joining in with others in the community in which they settle, we see cooperation between individuals. Earlier in the Bible, in Ecclesiastes, the writer talks about a three-stranded cord that cannot be broken. So rather than individual groups or charities or churches or the town council or the local authority trying to address the needs of the community, let us embrace working together for the common good, because we are better together than we are separate. The needs appear overwhelming. We expect that many people will present with mental health issues following the lockdown. We know that many in our community may have to remain isolated to protect them. Our children's education has been affected. People in Seaford will have lost jobs and their businesses. How will we be able to cope? In all of the media coverage, I haven't heard the following. This is a national crisis. So as a nation, we need to turn to prayer. I believe we need to seek God's help in this time of trouble, because I firmly believe that nothing is impossible with God. So we need to turn and ask for God's help at this time of crisis. Jesus' disciples went out and did amazing things. The sick were healed. People were delivered of evil spirits. But they didn't do any of this in their own strength. They went, empowered by the Holy Spirit, sent by Jesus Christ. And that's why involving the churches is important. And I would say that directly to the local authority and the town council. On your own, you will struggle. But if we work in partnership, then with God's help, we can accomplish far more than we can hope or imagine. And there's a message here for the churches in the town too, that there is far more that unites us than divides us. We all believe in one Jesus Christ, and we are all working towards bringing to fruition his kingdom, characterized by justice and righteousness. We may all have different ways of worshiping Jesus, but I believe that's healthy, because we all have different characters and personalities. So let us embrace our differences and celebrate that it is in Christ alone that we put our trust.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, this solid ground, burn through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when Jesus fills, when striving ceases, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, you took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns, calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ.
To close our time together today, the Seaford Silver Band will play us out with a locked-down version of Sussex by the Sea. It's customary at the end of the civic service for refreshments to be served and greetings to be brought by a number of people, including the High Sheriff and the Lord Lieutenant. So please continue watching after Sussex by the Sea to listen to those greetings and enjoy some cake and liquid refreshment at home. We hope you've enjoyed this virtual service today, and we look forward to the time when we will be able to gather in person once again. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
Councillor Stephen Gauntlett, I'm chair of Lewes District Council. About 100,000 people live in the district, and one of the privileges I have is to do things on their behalf. And so today I am delighted to welcome Councillor Rodney Reed as the new mayor of Seaford, and also his wife Anne, who is acting as his consort. I'm very aware that they moved to Seaford not that long ago, but already have made a big difference to the life of the town, being involved in so many good things that build the community. I'm also very pleased that the mayor has chosen a theme of cooperation for his year of office. In a time when there is so much sharp difference of opinion, collaboration and working through things together brings its own rewards. So, I'd like to say in closing my very, very best wishes for a most happy and productive term of office.
Hello, Councillor Steve Wallace here, the Mayor of Eastbourne, sending warm wishes and congratulations to Councillor Rodney Reed on becoming the Mayor of Seaford. Being the first citizen of the town you represent is a great honour and privilege. Over the next 12 months, you're going to be extremely busy. You're going to be meeting lots of residents, charities, organisations and businesses. It's a fun-packed year. The time goes extremely quickly, so enjoy it. I look forward to seeing you, hopefully, very soon. But in the meantime, enjoy your year of fun.
Mr. Mayor, I'm Andrew Blackman, High Sheriff of East Sussex, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to your new role on behalf of the county. I'm very sad that we can't be together today for this, your civic service, but very much look forward to visiting Seaford as soon as possible and to meeting you and Anne then.
I'm Councillor Alan Robbins, the Mayor of the City of Brighton and Hove, and I've been invited to say a few words for your virtual civic service. First of all, may I congratulate you, Councillor Reed, on becoming the Mayor of Seaford. It is indeed an honour and achievement to be elected as Mayor, and also an important opportunity to support your residents. The COVID-19 virus has completely changed the way we work and interact, and we have also learnt to become more tech savvy along the way. Your civic service, Councillor Reed, is a testimony on how we can get things done and how we can think creatively and differently when presented with challenges. I'll be watching on YouTube on the 4th of July, and I'm really looking forward to meeting you in person once we're out of lockdown. All my best wishes to you, Councillor Rodney Reed, on your year as Mayor of Seaford. We both know that this is going to be a memorable year for us all. In the words of the great Vera Lynn, we'll meet again, I'm sure. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, it is my pleasure to send you this message of good luck as you start your civic year as Mayor of Seaford. I wish you every success with your fundraising for charities, and I know that you will be an extremely good first citizen of the town. I look forward to meeting you soon. Bye-bye.
Hello, Councillor Reid. David Elkin here, Chairman of the County Council. Thank you for inviting me to your virtual civic service. And on behalf of the County Council, I'm delighted to congratulate you on your appointment as Mayor of Seaford. We wish you all the best for your coming year. Although this pandemic has frustrated so many of our plans, I've been extremely impressed with our capacity to adapt. Your virtual service and scheme to increase public awareness of local charities through the Council's website are a fine example of that. I look forward to meeting you in person when the guidance allows. Thank you.
Big congratulations here from Westminster to Councillor Rodney Reid on becoming the new Mayor of Seaford for this year. Rodney, I think you'll do a fantastic job. You've lived in the town of Seaford for many, many years. You've been involved in lots of groups and organisations that have done a huge amount for the town. So I think you'll enjoy the year and but also be a fantastic Mayor. And can I say I'm particularly impressed with your plans to look at all charities across Seaford this year rather than picking one or two, because I know from my post bag with the COVID virus that charities in particular have struggled to raise money but also get new volunteers with social distancing in place and you know, people being in isolation and not wanting or not being able to go out. So being able to support all charities across the town of Seaford is a fantastic idea. So good luck for your year. I'm sure I'll see you out and about across the town and hopefully at some of the engagements as they start to come back up and running. So good luck. You'll be a fantastic mayor for the town.